Hello there, everyone. This is James Lawrence again, and I'm continuing my study. First of all, let me say God bless you, and I pray that Jesus Christ is Lord of your life. If he is not, then you must know about him enough to where you feel like you want him to be in your life. You don't look at it as a fairy tale or something made up religiously by men, but rather the living Son of God who came and died for you, shedding his blood. He died on a cross, and afterward he was placed in a tomb and raised from the dead 3 days later for our salvation, our eternal life, okay, our sanctification during this lifetime, holiness, righteousness that God sees through Jesus to us. It's not our own righteousness, but it's that of Jesus Christ. And I want to say that at the beginning, please don't delay. Receive Jesus Christ today. So the acceptable time of salvation is any moment that you decide to ask him into your life. Okay. Now, what I was saying is that I've been doing these end-time judgments that are spoken of in the book of Revelation, 21 of them in the form of seven seals, and then seven trumpets, and then seven bowls. So the seals are opened. The trumpets are blown by angels, and bowls are poured out. And these all represent judgments. Now, are they literal? And really, is that important? Well, I think they're literal, yes. I believe Jesus literally opens seals, those seven seals, and then angels do blow the trumpets, whether in heaven or some of them doing it up in the heavens, up in the sky. Regardless, yes, I believe they blow them, and I believe they do pour out literal bowls that are up in heaven and represent these judgments that will fall. Now, what people need to realize is that the judgments in general are literal. They're not just made up fairy tale type things, but folks, they seem so, for lack of a better term, outrageous. But yet, praise God, that the Lord is going to show himself extremely mighty. He is the mightiest being that exists, and nothing would exist without him. He created all things, and I thank God for the judgments of God coming, because God will finally show himself stronger than any man ever thought that he could be. Now, the Antichrist is coming, and in the seven seals we saw where the Antichrist comes in immediately on the first seal that's broken. Jesus opens that seal. Here comes the Antichrist posing as Christ. From there, things get progressively worse. And now, with these seven seals being completed and the seven trumpets coming, things are much worse. They are scary worse. And you don't want to be left behind, and you don't have to be, because if you receive Jesus, as I said earlier, as your Lord and Savior, the Bible says you are delivered from the wrath to come. Okay? And there, in fact, there's a scripture I read yesterday, and in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10, it says it exactly like that. It said to wait for his Son from heaven, and those that are watching for him, of course, are those who belong to him. To wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Okay? How much plainer can that be? The wrath to come. It's God's wrath being poured out in these seven, each one seven, equaling three sets of seven, 21 judgments. And then this other one in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 says, "For God hath not appointed us to wrath." Now, this is Paul talking to the church in Thessalonica, and he is saying God hasn't appointed us to wrath. So he's including himself, and he's talking to a church of believers. He says, then, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so let me read these seven judgments. Now, I'm going to show you something, because you're going to laugh. You're going to laugh at this. But I write notes just at a time that I feel inspired about something. I'll look it up either on the computer, sometimes in my Bible. And I've gone to computer a lot. It's so convenient, you know. And most pastors are doing that. Preachers, teachers. I'm a teacher. But these are the notes. I just found a spiral notebook and seven trumpets. Seven seals, seven trumpets, and then the seven bowls. I don't have that filled in yet, but I've got writing all over it. And you may say, how can you even read that, James? Well, sometimes I even ask that of myself. I think, how can I read my own notes? Because they're written in my own special shorthand. You could say it's my own special kind. But yes, I can read them. Don't ask me how, I guess, because I've practiced for a long time. But I write them fast, and what I did yesterday, and I told you this, I said, I'm not reading from the scriptures on the judgments themselves. Now, I read some scriptures before I began reading about the seals that Jesus opens, the seven seals. But I didn't read from the scriptures, and so therefore, there's not perfection in what I say, but I'm giving you a pretty good general idea of the things that are going to happen with each of these judgments. I got one a little bit, I missed out on saying something in the sixth seal where it talks about meteors falling from heaven, stars from falling from heaven like figs from a tree, ripe figs from a tree and falling to the earth. And so I had to go ahead and put that in a note in the description as a secondary note, as a after the fact, after the video note. So I hope people will see that. I put it as a comment also because I wanted to absolutely share. I mean, we're talking about the book of Revelation. You're not supposed to add to or take away from this book of the prophecy. But see, you have to understand, I'm not, if I make a mistake, this is different than purposefully saying, I'm going to change what this says. No, I would never do that in a million years. I wouldn't even know how. But I can make mistakes. I'm just a man. Every man who's ever preached from the book of Revelation has likely made a mistake. Okay, and I will too. That wasn't the last one yesterday. But I do the best I can. It's complicated. You say you should leave it to the theologians. We are the theologians. The body of Christ. We are called all to be theologians who expound upon the Word of God for others to understand, who haven't understood the things you do as yet. But we have to do it in humility, and we can't act like know-it-alls and things like that. And I've never attempted to do that, but if I have at times, it was inadvertent on my part. I didn't mean to. But let me start with these trumpets. These are found from all the way from Revelation chapter 8. To the first half, I believe, of the 11th chapter to about the verse 19 of the 11th chapter. Anyway, so about parts of three different chapters, two whole chapters and parts of a third chapter. Yeah, that's a better way to put it. But these seven trumpets, the first one that is blown in heaven by an angel. These angels are appointed to blow these at the appropriate time when Jesus or the Heavenly Father, all of them really in the Holy Spirit, because they're so in unison, they say, blow the first trumpet. You know, the angel is commanded, and when the trumpet is blown on that first one, hail and fire with blood is cast down to the earth. This fire from this hail, it burns one-third of trees and the green grass. It burns a third of the green grass as well. That's pretty horrible all by itself. The second trumpet is sounded and an asteroid, I would call it, or a meteor, if you want to call it that, looking like a mountain that's on fire. Okay, this is how John observed it and this is how he wrote it. Looked like a mountain. It was so huge it looked like a mountain falling from the sky on fire. That's a meteor. I saw one once that looked like that, literally. But it streaked across the sky. I could hear crackling from it. And it was huge. It was seen in three states. I saw it the next morning in the newspaper. This was years ago, but I did see it. It lit the sky so much that the street lights went out in town. And it had a greenish glow to it, and that's no joke. It really did. And it was just magnificent, and I was just, I can't believe what I saw. Anyway, looks like a mountain and it falls into the sea. One-third of the sea creatures die and one-third of the ships are destroyed. You know, meteors can break up and fall in pieces. Could it be that some of it falls into the different oceans? And you know what I'm saying? So that it falls into a lot of the sea. Because if there's only one sea that it falls into, how could it be that great that one-third of the ships are destroyed too? Not many ships are in a small sea. This is talking about something very large and significant. Okay, so a third of the sea creatures die because of this fiery mountain meteor falling to the earth, and a third of the ships. Okay, then the third trumpet is sounded. Stars fall from the heavens that look like, let me start over, it's not stars plural. A star falls from heaven that looks like a burning torch, and it affects a third of rivers and springs, a third of springs and rivers, and it brings poisonous bitterness to these bodies of water. So here we have the rest of the bodies of water being affected by another meteor that falls. Makes the waters bitter. People who drink of it die because the waters are made poison by this. Could it be radiation poisoning? We don't know. However, yeah, most likely there's a lot of it has to do with that, but it could also just have absolute high levels of certain metals that are very poisonous to human beings. Okay, so all kinds of things. It makes absolute sense that would happen. Okay, the fourth trumpet afterwards is then sounded. And darkness strikes one-third of all light-bearing bodies that are in the heavens above, like the sun, the moon, and even the stars. The stars bring light. Have you ever been out somewhere where all lights, city lights and things, natural lights were gone? Did you know the sky looks really lit up? I've been out like that camping and things like that. Yes, it's amazing. So all of these will be darkened by one-third. That's amazing. One-third. Well, one-third of the angels fell from heaven when they rebelled against God originally. Now, I don't know if that enters into this, but it's amazing. One-third. It keeps mentioning that number or that fraction. And it says that a third of all these bodies in heaven that provide light are darkened. Day and night are both a third darker, and a pause occurs afterward. While an angel, after this darkening of day and night both, he warns of much greater terror coming with the next three trumpets that are blown. So there's a pause for an angel to shout, "Woe unto you on earth. Here comes the next three trumpets. They will be horrible." Okay, so the fifth trumpet does sound. When it does, a star falling to earth, like it's likely an angel that's coming down. People have argued over, is this an evil angel or one of God's angels? Well, a star falls from heaven to the earth and opens something called the bottomless pit. We don't see this, and no, we don't see the opening of it, because some people say, "We have found the opening to the bottomless pit." You know, you'll see these clickbait type videos, which I'm disappointed in some people who have done these, that I really enjoyed their ministry at first. But when I see, they'll have a circle around somebody's eye with an arrow coming to it, and it'll have nothing to do with the video. So anyway, I don't know why they did. I don't mind. I've got one that has a circle that's pointing to a couple of dove that were in my backyard. And I have an arrow to it that shows that. But that's the only one I've done like that. However, I might do more. Well, let's say I got one coming up here a little later after I do the bold judgments that are in the book of Revelation, which are after these trumpets that will complete the last seven, equaling the 21 I just talked about. Seven, seven, and seven, 21. These seven trumpets I'm talking about. Now, it says that this angel that falls and opens the bottomless pit because he's given the key to it. This is a place spiritually we cannot see it. However, the spirit, as we can see, is the spirit realm is crossing over into the physical. Now, I don't know how that happens, and I don't know why necessarily. I don't know why it happens. At times I do, of course, like such as when Abraham was visited by the angels who said he was going to have a child at his old age, okay, and so forth. They were physical men, but they were also angels. How did they become physical? God allowed them to. It's just that simple. God can allow things to do that. Anyway, he goes to the bottomless pit, and he opens it, and out comes huge plumes of smoke, or a plume. One gigantically huge plume of smoke, like out of a volcano. You've seen volcanoes like Mount St. Helens when it exploded. There was a huge plume of smoke. I remember seeing it when I was younger. And from a distance, the plume, the cloud that came up, mushroom cloud, it looked like something like a nuclear blast had to happen. So this is going to look like something like that. It's going to be a dark plume of smoke. And out of that smoke, as the smoke begins to not dissipate but spread out, it then appears as locusts in the sky. These locusts will have the power to sting like a scorpion. Now, is this horrible or not? Yes, you know it is. I'm not trying to take it lightly at all. I don't whatsoever. But I know some people hearing things like this, they say, you know what, James Lawrence, this is just too much. The Bible, you know, I'm beginning to see this as a fairy tale or something. Well, that's your bad. That's your bad because, no, it's not. These are judgments of God. These things, these types of things do exist already, okay? And what's going to happen is they're going to be given, they're going to be unleashed, okay? Because right now they're kind of on a leash, just to give an analogy. But when they're unleashed, horrible things are going to happen. They do exist. Okay. And it says that these demons torment men with stings like a scorpion for 5 months. And it says during this time of being struck by these scorpions in their bodies, they're going to be wanting to die. And it says they will seek to die and they won't be able to. Now, this is very strange. There will probably be angels that are observing, and as soon as a person attempts to commit suicide to get away from the judgment that they must go through, until God says they can, they do not have to go through it, but they can be killed, such as for their testimony in Jesus Christ. If they receive Jesus during the Great Tribulation period, then of course they can die because they will be killed by the Antichrist and his people. They will be beheaded, most likely. But whatever way, they are martyrs, meaning they die for their faith. But people will seek to die and will not be able to. But then comes the sixth trumpet. There's an army that is formed by 4 angels that are loosed from the Euphrates River. And they number this army they gather. Numbers 200 million soldiers on horseback. The best way to go through terrain, some terrain in the world, even tanks, they don't use for it. They use horseback. And it's the best way to get more soldiers into an area. It's funny how when wars begin, more men go on foot. They call them foot soldiers because they can go places the large machinery can't go, and they can be unheard if they sneak in. So sometimes that is the best way, and the 200 million man army will kill 1/3 of the earth's population. Now John sees up close some demons that I believe these are the demons, the locusts. They're larger than, even though they look like locusts coming out of the bottomless pit. Now, please know, there may be some speculation on my part on this, but it may be very correct at the same time. I've said this before. John gets a close-up look at these demon spirits, and when he does, there's quite a description of them. They have hair like women, could be the flaps of a helmet, teeth like a lion, the grill of one. They are on these machines. They sound like many, many thousands of men on horseback, in chariots. So the rumbling of them coming, weaponry, because they can shoot fire and brimstone out of their mouths. Okay, is it coming from their mouths, or did John see these things the way he needed to describe them? Because they didn't know what modern weaponry was back then. Fire and brimstone shooting out of their mouths. Think about it. Okay, so these huge number of demons are all over the earth, and they kill 1/3 of all people with this fire and brimstone that they shoot out. Okay, so I'm now down to the 7th trumpet, and I have just a piece of paper that I needed to add here. Okay, this 7th trumpet, you could call it a judgment that comes for the dead. Now, there's 24 elders, and I mentioned this with the 7 seals that are sitting on thrones around the throne of God. Okay, and they say the time has come to judge people that are dead, and to destroy, to put to death those that caused destruction on the earth. Now, you know, they have this climate change thing that they say man has caused it. Well, yeah, he has. However, this kind of destruction is that in which men have, they've blown things up with gigantic bombs. They have polluted the waters with the oil and the spills and things like that. They have polluted just simply by polluting. I mean, and yes, cars and things, they're a necessity. God's not stupid, and he doesn't say, okay, everyone that ever drove a car, we're going to have to kill them. No, no, no. Please, let's look at this maturely and realize that people who destroy the earth are like those that for many, many years they took lumber from certain areas, but it was the company themselves. It was the lumber company, and they would cut the trees down but not replant them. Well, finally, they had enough sense to know, hey, we cut all these down. There's not any left. And this helps oxygenate the earth. Plants and trees do, yes. So they began to replant as they would cut these down. Smart, huh? So, but it took them an awful long time. And there's still destruction of things. The waters are polluted by just absolute. I mean, they have dumping grounds in the oceans, in the waters of the oceans. They do. I mean, there are certain areas, and they've made islands of trash in them and so forth. There's just all kinds of ways that this is done. But the really responsible people are the ones who they set things up to be this way. They are the CEOs of these companies and so forth. They are destroying the earth. It is the truth. I'm not saying that I agree necessarily with the climate movement. Not necessarily all of it, but I'm not going to get political about it, okay? I just want you to know that there are ways in which man has been destroying the earth ever since he's been here, pretty much. Burning things and actually setting fires on purpose and burning huge amounts of wooded areas and the people's homes that are within those and stuff like that. That's happened so much that it's I couldn't even begin to quote the numbers of acres that are in the possibly billions by now, but probably in the at least many millions and of the homes and things and people that have died because of fires that people set intentionally, sometimes just for the fun of it. Okay, if they've repented, God can even forgive that sin. Did you know that? Yes. Yes, he can forgive murder or anything else, but they must repent. But it does say that these people will die who have destroyed the earth. And they will be judged, of course. Now, they're going to die anyway, whether naturally or they die during the Great Tribulation period because they're left behind. But they will be judged at a judgment for causing destruction on the earth. Then, the Bible says that there's thunders and huge crashing sounds, lightning flashes, of course, and then thunder. Sorry, I got that a little backwards there, but But an earthquake again happens on the earth, and an extremely bad hail storm. Hail that is huge, you know, ice and stuff, maybe mingled with other things. Fall from the sky. But anyway, it's hailstones that are so huge that the Bible describes them as being something that just one can kill a person easily. It can kill any size animal on the earth, an elephant. If an elephant is hit in the head with one of these, he'll drop dead. Because it's something like, well, I'm guessing here, but I was thinking that someone said when they calculated it that they weigh 100 pounds each. Could you withstand a 100-pound stone falling on your head? Well, neither could any animal on earth right now. Possibly a whale. But I would say, other than that, no. And even then, the whale could die because the force of it coming down from the skies would be tremendous. And so they would have to be in enough water that it would cushion it, and then it would float a little bit and hit them. But I'm being a little too destructive and almost getting childish with it, so I need to stop doing that. So, but anyway, folks, they are also talking about in this this seventh trumpet judgment, that the seal judgments back up. Seal judgments first, trumpets were next. Now the bowls are coming. Okay? So the bowl judgments are going to be next. Okay, so that's pretty much a rundown of what happens from about Revelation 8. You see, the seals were from about chapter 6 to chapter 8. And then the trumpets from chapter 8 to somewhere about the middle or a little past the middle of chapter 11. Now when we come to the bowl judgment, it's going to be chapter 11 through chapter 15. And folks, is there some overlap on some of these? I said that in the last one. I believe that there is. However, it is so astronomically horrible that it's something, it's hard for our minds to fathom it. Yes, the book of Revelation is very unique as far as the wrath of God goes. There's nothing like it. And it's all going to happen. Whether people believe it or not, still going to happen. Praise God and thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for being the great and mighty Savior who came to deliver us from the wrath to come and to save us. Receive Him today and become born again, a new creature inside. He will recreate you a new spirit in you, and you will be born again. That's why they call it the new birth. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. And you become a new creature in Christ, a new creation in Him. Okay? Praise God. So please receive Him today and don't delay. God bless you, and thank you for hearing me. I will talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.